Welcome to the Planning Board meeting for Monday, January 9th, 2017. I'd like to start out with a Happy New Year to everyone here. And also, we canceled our last meeting in December, which we traditionally have given a gift to the three people that support us really well every year. And it's a small token that we give them, but I want to recognize them today on camera, Kobe and Jennifer and Elaine. And we really appreciate it, and we gave the maximum that the Ethics Commission would allow us to give each one, which is just a token of our appreciation. But thank you very much, and we got a very nice card tonight from Jennifer, which I'm going to embarrass her by reading it to you all.
If
you can open it.
Oh, this is Kobe. Oh, Kobe, I'm sorry. Dear Planning Board members, thank you so much for the gift certificate. I'll have fun spending it. Best wishes for the new year, Kobe. And then Jennifer's is here. And it's a board members, thank you so much for the generous gift card you gave me for Christmas. It was very unexpected and is greatly appreciated. I look forward to continuing to work with all of you in the new year. Thanks again, Jennifer. So basically, we've got a couple of cards here. And
thank you for the cards.
Yeah.
You're welcome.
And, okay. Then my second thanks is to HCAM for recording the meeting. We are missing, I guess, one member tonight, I believe. And we've got a relatively interesting agenda tonight, but not a lot as far as scheduled items. We'll probably take them in the order that's in here. Before we get to the agenda, some of the things we're going to be talking about is a minor modification to Legacy North Villages. We'll have a discussion about the subdivision feasibility off of Chamberlain and Wayland Road. And then we have a bunch of administrative things to do until we get to a master plan update, which we are getting very close to finalizing it. Maybe we get there tonight pretty well or not. And then the last thing, I'd like to offer a moment of silence for the passing of John Duffy. John Duffy was a planning board member well before I even moved to town, so it seems like a long, long, long time ago. But as a former member, I think we should acknowledge him with a moment of silence. Okay, the first item of business is, I really appreciated Pam's Waxlex, who's the Charter Commission, Charter Review Commission Chairman, reaching out to us to want to talk about some changes that we've been discussing at the last couple meetings and at the Charter Review. And I think that's really good that you're out there trying to smooth things over before the town meeting and try to explain it to us, and really appreciate you coming in today. And it was her idea to do that, and you're our first guest here. And why don't you explain the changes that really affect the planning board and some of the thinking that went through between your last public hearing and where you are today?
Okay. So thank you for having me. I'd also like to introduce my vice chair, Michelle Murdoch, is serving on the charter review with me. I'm going to give some background on the process and whatnot, and then specifically as they relate to the planning board. So every 10 years, Hockington's charter calls for a review of the charter and for the special committee formed to complete this review to make a report with recommendations to town meeting. The committee conducted interviews and sent questionnaires to town officials, boards, and committees seeking input. We held two public forums this fall to obtain input from the community at large. We also investigated benchmark communities for comparison purposes. The goal of all proposed changes to Hockington's town charter is to streamline town government, to make board and committee structure more consistent, and to enable an efficient and effective town government capable of meeting evolving responsibilities and demands. The proposed amendments to the original town charter created in 2006 fall into the following categories: one, editorial changes, including reorganization, additions, deletions, and clarifications. Two, changes to the annual budget process. Three, updates to the reporting structure for town employees who report to and or work with town boards or committees. And four, a recommendation to change the position of town clerk from an elected to an appointed position. All proposed changes are the result of months of research, discussion, review, and comparison to the selected benchmark communities, as well as input and feedback from residents, town officials, boards, and committees. We realize that our opinions are not necessarily in alignment with those of the majority of people we encounter through the public forum process, but after examining the data from those forums, as well as information and data gathered through other means, these are the recommendations we present. All proposed amendments were unanimously voted by the Charter Review Committee. With respect to the Planning Board, the following should be noted. The composition and term of office paragraph, and this pretty much goes with the second page I've given you, or the page I gave you, I should say, which is the second page to mine. The composition, term of office paragraph, and the powers and duties paragraph have minor wording changes made to them to bring them in line with the wording for other elected bodies in town. The appointment of the town planner is by the Planning Board, as is the goal setting. The town manager only has input in the goal setting. Article 3, sections 3.2b, 5 through 7, relating to the town manager, ensures any supervision is consistent with the goals set by the Planning Board. The town manager's role is to facilitate the evaluation of, in your case, the town planner, ensuring all employees receive an annual evaluation, and any discipline of the town planner would be subject to appeal by the board, by the Planning Board. There's one other piece that I didn't include in here that I'm realizing now might be is not an issue because I've discussed it already, I believe, with you, Ken. We had recommended that the warrant for annual town meeting be closed 90 days prior to town meeting rather than 60 days as the current policy to better tie in financial planning purpose for financial planning
right,
purposes.
We didn't have any problem. Yeah. I mean, we'll meet whatever schedule that you guys determine.
So that's the gist of the changes are not really changes to what's in the charter that we're proposing in relation to the Planning Board.
So let's kind of open that for discussion. The members that we had three concerns. It looks like the appointment one has been kind of fixed to what our recommendation was. And the other ones, the wording has changed a little bit. I don't know how people feel about it.
So I'll start out, Mr.
Okay.
Chairman, if I may, with a question. And Michelle, appreciate the work. Appreciate you guys coming in here. Just to clarify a couple things. So the Planning Board will appoint the town planner, correct?
Correct.
And then the review is done, and is done by the Planning Board, or is it done by the town manager?
It's facilitated by the town manager, which means
yeah.
that if the Planning Board does not complete a review on an annual basis, the town manager will step in to ensure that the employee does get an annual review.
So that makes sense. Is that in writing, or
mm-hmm.
is that okay? That's
I think it's in. I think it's number 7.
And then the discipline of that. Review or any part of what the town planner determined to be a disciplinary type of action would be done by the Planning Board or the town manager?
The town manager would make the initial disciplinary action. The employee, in this case the town planner, would have the right to appeal to the Planning Board.
Okay.
It ensures that somebody who's here on a daily basis, should something happen, they're able to step in immediately. They don't need the 48 hours to call a meeting and take care of whatever. It's worst case scenario.
So if I
go ahead.
No, you keep going.
I'll stop there.
Okay. So if when you say facilitate annual, if we do our job, everything is cool.
Correct.
That we would continue to do it.
Correct.
And if it's only if we did not, and the facilitate also could solve the problem of we cannot poll nine members of the board within an open meeting, but the town manager can pull and write a summary of nine comments for us to discuss the summary in open meeting. So that could solve that part of the issue. And the discipline of all employees, I think I understand in the near term, if for some reason the planning board, and probably not this planning board or in the future, because was unhappy with our town planner, then we could initiate with the town manager to start the discipline, right, too.
You could also do it yourselves.
Right. I mean,
this is just saying that
in an emergency,
right,
type situation, right?
We could also, since we can appoint the town planner, we can unappoint the town planner, I would think, too.
Correct.
I mean, that kind of goes along with saying.
That's what's intended.
Okay.
Is there a situation where that authority would not be managed by the planning board? Would it have to be managed by the town manager to hire and fire?
For the town planner, it would be the planning board. The situation would be you cede the authority
to the town manager.
to hire the town planner.
So I have some problems and questions with what we're talking about. You mentioned that a lot of the feedback you got was different from what the board's suggested, but you have made changes from what we had suggested at previous Albert forums, which is, I thank you guys for. One of the things you mentioned on Tuesday night's meeting was that we wanted to, one of the goals, which you didn't mention here, one of the goals is to have the interdepartmental cooperation increase, and that is something we are working towards as well within Department of Land Use and Planning, with conservation and planning board being updated of different decisions that are being made sometimes at the same time, but we need to be aware of what's going on with each. So I think we do, in general, as a group, at least from my perspective, like to have interdepartment working together and more smoothly. But my problem, one thing here is that the planning board now, with the new changes, does have the authority to hire the town planner. But the oversight of the town manager, from a managerial perspective, I think is not called for and it's inefficient because it's adding work to the town manager for every group, for the town manager to have that oversight. My understanding, when we started the town charter so we could hire a town manager, was so we could have better fiscal control of the budget. And I think that's the main reason we have a town manager, is to manage the town and the town budget. And giving him the extra, giving that person an extra responsibility, that could be handled by, say, the HR director in regards to anything that needs to be done for reviews. The HR director could reach out to departmentally with the planning board, say, your town planner needs a annual review and it needs to be done by so-and-so date, and there's a general outline of what we consider to be acceptable, and here are our goals and stuff that we've developed with our town planner. I think that the planning board does not need the additional input from the town manager for this. Just I appreciate the changes you made, but I think that last bit is where I'm stuck.
Well, let me read to that specific section where we're talking about supervising. So this is from the town manager section. To supervise all employees of the town other than employees of the school department, police department, fire department, and town clerk's office. Wait, no, which one? Is that the one?
Yeah, that's you're right.
Yeah. Okay. And you keep going, provided, however, that supervision of employees appointed other than by the town manager, in your case the town planner,
right,
shall be performed by both the employee's appointing authority and the town manager or a designee. So it's not necessarily the town manager will be supervising. He can designate Elaine as land use planning
or HR
or HR or for whatever need whatever needs to happen, he can designate that that off. So he can say, Director of HR Maria, you make sure everybody's got an annual evaluation.
But we did discuss the need to have someone here. Your concern of having someone on site to be in charge. But from my perspective, the planning board is elected, and we hire a town planner, and the town planner reports to the planning board. Now, the department underneath her, as we discussed Tuesday, Michelle's point was that all the other employees, well, they report to the town planner or the whatever structure we have, which currently is the director of land use and planning. That structure is underneath the town manager in that personnel grouping, but the position of the director is unique to reporting to us. And then everyone that that director hires is an employee of the town, employee of that department, and reports to the town hall structure.
Mm-hmm.
So I like to see the directors of all the boards and groups that are hired to be have that level of independence where they work for the board and they there's no conflict, where they have they're able to represent the board's issues here in town hall on a daily basis, working with the town manager, but not for the town manager. And that working for the town manager at any level takes away some of the independence that Ed Wharton described last Tuesday.
So give me an example of where you think a conflict would arise in with respect to the planning board, because that's what we're talking about, right?
There, say, a business wanted to come into town and say that it was like a restaurant permit, and they start talking to the town manager. And the town manager would say, okay, well, great, we'll talk to our land use and planning people, talk to our Chamber of Commerce people, and see what the town's like to have to do business in. And that's where that should end. It shouldn't have any other role over people that are doing the work underneath them. It's, I think, a conflict of interest where it's, say, as a solid example. I can't give you a solid example because I think that there's nothing wrong so far, but what could go wrong is that if the town manager seems to perceive or show a perception or favoritism from one business over another, and say there's two restaurants vying for the same spot, the director should just be holding to this board, not to any other opinions in the town hall about things that go on in town.
But I guess go read the paragraph again, because I think the intent of what we were trying to do was not have the person directly supervised, correct?
Well, it's saying consistent with the annual goals set by
the board.
The board, effectively. So if you set the goals that all restaurants are evaluated independently, then there's no way to... I can see what you're saying, where there could be a feeling like there's a dual... dual reporting structure, but we've tried to set it up with legal language such that it's the policy goals are set by the board, and the town manager just makes sure that they get followed, is the best way, or enacted.
Well, not to go too far down the rabbit hole, the example Ed Wharton brought up on Tuesday was that Norman's doing his job saying, this is the budget. Ed's doing his job saying, well, this is what we need, and there was the balance that had to be met between the budget and the need.
Mm-hmm.
And Ed, feeling that they needed more resources, wasn't getting them, feels that in that position where there's oversight over him by the town manager, where he's hired by an elected board, reports to an elected board, but if he has to, this is what I heard him saying, if he has to also consider that this is a person who has oversight over part of his review, he's not going to be able to represent the Board of Health and citizens of Hopkinton as best as he could, because he has to consider, here's his boss and he's clashing with his boss on the budget.
Mm-hmm.
And both people are doing their jobs, but if you put them in that conflict, where it's an ethical conflict between them, that possibly that could impede what both guys need to do, both positions need to do.
So I guess the only thing I would answer to that would be the Board of Health would be responsible for being the supporter for the needs of the health department, and saying, going to the Board of Selectmen saying, this budget isn't adequate to meet our needs. We have to have it increased by this, this, and this, by this amount, because we have these regulations we have to follow and we don't have the money. I think of that as a Board of Health issue. With regards to the evaluation, the town manager is not doing the evaluation. He's facilitating in the sense of ensuring it gets done.
Excuse me, through the chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
Who is currently overseeing that now?
Overseeing what?
That things are being done to the standard that is being set forth now.
That Mass General, for Board of Health?
For across the board. All boards.
For evaluations?
Yes, for evaluations.
Oh, I would assume, and I don't know this correctly.
Excuse me for my ignorance, because I'm new to the board, but
it's under the Human Resources Department. They monitor who's received evaluations, and in the personnel policies of the town, it requires that an evaluation is completed annually, and technically, if an evaluation has not been performed, the employee is not supposed to be getting any raises. So this ensures that the personnel policies of the town are followed, and that.
Can you give me an instance, or give this board an instance of when something like that has occurred that made you want to make that change?
To ensure that everybody gets one?
Yeah, like has there been an incident where there's not been reviews in it?
Yes, and I can't share the specific information.
Okay. So is that the reasoning why we're here today?
For the evaluation portion, for this particular piece on the evaluation, yes, definitely, is to ensure that all employees of the town are treated consistently and fairly.
And what you're stating is it's not happening right now because it's not being oversought correctly?
There have been instances where it hasn't happened because of the structure that's set up in the currently in place today.
So putting that on the town manager to make the decision to direct, does that oversee his stated duties as the town manager?
I didn't follow the last part.
Are we giving him too much power, is what he's basically asking. And I think the answer is no, because if you look at it, what we did is we heard very strongly that the boards wanted to keep the personnel reporting to them, and they've all kept that. So, to go the complete opposite way, we could have said, the town planner reports to the town manager, period. And we had a lot of input that people didn't want it to work that way. And I think by allowing the key word is input by the town manager, we're trying to promote teamwork and have somewhat of a compromise, but basically the boards kept their reports.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
So just real quickly, so you looked at other towns?
Yes.
And how do they do it? What's the best model? What do you
So we didn't specifically look at in terms of evaluations, because we didn't go,
that deep,
to use your word, down that rabbit hole that long, that far. We looked the 17 benchmark communities we looked at in terms of appointed and elected boards and committees, how their budget process worked.
For other factors, not specifically this one. Okay, thank
right.
you.
Right.
You guys were a little bit easier in terms of there were some boards that it was tossed out might be better appointed. And that in that case, we could compare, is the Board of Health appointed or elected in those 17 towns? In their
right.
case, it was roughly, what did we say, nine
half
out
half.
Half and half, that type of thing. Your board was always going to be elected, so.
Okay. Other discussions? Questions?
I have a question.
Go Go ahead, Vincent.
It says here that the town manager has the right to consolidate, create, merge, divide, or abolish in whole or part any town department, board, or committee or office over which they have control. What's the check to that?
The Board of Selectmen. So he, it's an it's in the current charter as it stands today. It's an administrative order. It's similar. It's exactly what happened when the Land Use and Planning Department was created. He pulls together the information, sets up the administrative order. He presents it publicly, presents it to the Board of Selectmen, and I believe there's a 60-day window, at which point, once that has passed and it's been accepted, it goes into...
But basically, that can't trump a paragraph in the charter that sets up an elected planning board.
Correct. Right. Oh, absolutely, right. Yes.
And that's
so that would be for, I'll say, reorganizing the permitting department,
right,
one way or the other.
Right.
Right.
Okay. I don't know. I'm detecting a consensus that we're reasonably happy with these, I think.
Point of order first.
Oh, go ahead.
Last Tuesday, we talked about the latest revision of the charter was from the previous Monday. And in our packets, we don't have that version. So
I changed two S's on appropriation committee, and we removed a period.
Right.
Okay.
That was a double period on the DPW special act.
Okay, so these changes were more prior.
Yeah, yes.
Prior
so
to Tuesday.
Correct.
Yeah.
The packets that we have now.
The packet we have now, I think Jennifer printed it off of the website or something.
The newest version is online.
Correct.
Yes, it is.
The recommended charter from the charter review committee that we're taking to special town meeting is available online. It's available in hard copy in the town clerk's office, the library, and the senior center as well.
Are you comfortable, Fred? You entertain the motion that Pam put in her memo, which was a nice one.
Can I ask one question before you do that?
Yeah.
No,
disrupt the whole thing.
No, it's
why
fine.
Not? It could cause problems, I
it
think.
Will.
So we've been talking about that you appoint the town planner, and as I'm sitting here, Jennifer's
we'll
name
take
tag
care of that.
Is down there.
We'll take care of that.
Principal. So
we'll
I just don't
care.
Want to cause
we'll
a problem.
We'll take care of that.
Okay.
That's in work.
She works for the town planner, who happens also to be the director of Land Use and Planning.
Okay.
Currently. Fred?
Make a motion to approve the statement set forth by Pam in the...
It's in the top of the...
Do you
email.
Want this one?
No.
Yeah. Is that the one? Is that the one we're using?
At the very bottom?
Yeah. The planning board endorsed the revisions of the town of Hoppington Home Rule Charter proposed by the Charter Review Committee to the extent that such revisions relate to the planning board and as set forth in the draft proposal charter provided by the Charter Review Committee.
Do I hear a second? I hear a second. Are you guys ready for a vote?
Discussion.
Go ahead.
All right, guys, I'll be voting no on this. And the specific reason is that I don't think the town manager should have input over directors that are hired by elected boards. No offense, I appreciate everything you compromised on. But for me, that's an underlying issue. I think overall, I'm opposed to changing the town clerk from elected to appointed. And I'm a little concerned that if we approve this in any measure, even though it's just concerning the planning board section, it could be construed to approve the whole.
I think the motion is really...
Yeah. Sure, but that's my concern.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
I've been
understood.
Let me make two comments on that. Number one, I believe the town council suggested that if you want to have an amendment at town meeting, which is January 30th.
Monday the 30th.
At
7 p.m. in the Hopkinton Middle School Auditorium.
This
okay.
is the special town meeting?
Correct.
Special. And there's a lot of other stuff on that special town meeting. With lots of bucks, so people ought to go there. If you have a proposed amendment, we suggest that you have it reviewed by town council. You can give him the idea, and then he will take it forward. So if you don't like something, he's encouraging you to, because making one simple change, one spot might domino throughout the thing, that, and a lot of people on town meeting floor might not understand where all the dominoes are going to fall. So he's, I think, offered through probably Pam of, this is an amendment I might want to do, maybe not relating to these paragraphs or not, but if you're, you know, dissenting and want to go that far, let's do it beforehand to make town meeting a lot easier, so that at least we're voting on things we can implement, and that's the key. I mean, they might go up and down one way or the other, but anyway.
I hear that.
Yeah.
But it's also totally fine to bring up any changes on the floor.
Absolutely.
It's better if it's all written out. It's better if it's reviewed.
It is.
But the risk is the whole thing versus nothing versus making the changes, and you made the changes mostly.
And it might end up being a two-day town meeting because they need time to go fix things like that, too.
Right.
And that's what I think a lot of people would prefer not to do that. But, I mean, that's so I'm just using some TV time to suggest that.
To work through town manager if somebody has an idea for an amendment. And he will work with town council, and he will put you in touch with town council.
And my other concern with that is
you don't have to, and the better part of it, you don't have to write it all out in great detail. You just have to give him a quick idea of what it is, and then he'll give you the words.
How expensive is that?
I don't know.
It's not our problem. This is more internal to the board, but yeah. So, I think we have a motion on the floor.
Any
further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Nay.
Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you, Pam. And
thank
we
you.
Will see you again on the 30th.
Yes. Thank you very much, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Good luck. Next thing up, Mark, I think you're up next.
How you doing, Mark?
Good. How are you? Hi, hello.
Happy New Year.
Same to you.
This is a minor modification to a building design for Legacy North Village. We have received a letter from Design Review. They approved it with a couple of changes to the design, which have been implemented by Pulte. And so, Mark, if you just kind of present it, we talked about this in our meeting in December. We introduced it a little bit, but we wanted Design Review to comment on it before we got there. So,
yeah.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For the record, Mark Mastriani, Pulte Homes of New England, here talking about the our latest villages at Legacy Farms North. As Ken mentioned, we were here last month, and this board approved a few minor modifications to our approval. And there was three approvals at that meeting. There was a fourth request. It's a minor modification to the comprehensive architectural package that we worked through with this board and with the Design Review Committee. And we held off discussing about that request at the last meeting because we took the time to go to the Design Review Board first. So we went to the Design Review Board on December 20th. We had a fruitful discussion with them. They asked us to make a couple revisions to the architecture, specifically the Florence architecture. So I guess to step back, the request is, one is to replace the province architectural plan with a Florence plan. That's a duplex unit. And the second request is to just add in a simplex plan called the Bankside. So those are the two minor modification requests. So the Design Review Board liked the Bankside, and they approved it as previously submitted. And they asked us to make two changes to the Florence unit. The first was to add louvers to two of the dormers on the two of the front elevations because they thought that they needed a little bit more architectural detail. So we've, in the resubmittal to this board, we added those to the two elevations. And then they asked us to add, to break up the side elevation on the Florence unit by adding shakes to the peak, so that you'll have lap siding on the bottom and then you'll have shakes on the top. And we've added that as well and resubmitted it to this board.
Is this the one that's added things to it, or do we have an old version?
Yeah, on sheet A16 and the revision date over in the corner, January 2017.
Okay.
So on the right side elevation, you can see the shakes up on the peak there, which breaks up the facade.
Yep. What about the louvers?
Oh, and the louvers, now that you have it on, in front of you, on FL5, FLV, and FLVII, which is the Florence 7.
Okay.
So those two, they have a dormer up there, and to break up the roof line, and above the windows, we added the detail, the little louver. And that was a request that they had to break up that area.
Okay. Go ahead.
Is it because it was such a blank space?
That's
basically what it was?
Yeah, that was their comment. They thought it could use a little bit more detail. And they and that was something that they had suggested us to consider doing.
And then also on the one story with the loft, I see you're doing a hip like type.
It's not a hip. It's a peak. And it's broken up, so the peak will be broken up with some trim and then some shakes above it. So it's varying the siding types in order to break up the facade and add more detail.
Further discussion?
Question?
Go ahead.
For these roof lines, will they be higher up? Will they change any of the elevations?
No, not at all. Mm-mm. The architecture is very, very similar to the package.
Okay.
The bank side is a new plan that our designers had in production when we were going through the approval, but it wasn't done yet. They've since completed it. They've and we'd like to add it to the mix. But it's very consistent with the other architecture. And the Florence, the same reason. It was in production. It wasn't ready at the time of doing the architectural package. We've since received feedback that the Florence is a better plan than the Province. So we're asking to actually replace the Florence replace the Province with the Florence, because the feedback we're getting from our customers is that the Florence is a better plan, and people are, it's not being, the Province is not being received well where it's being built.
So what would be the equivalent, through the chair, of the one-story with loft view of the Florence? How would that compare to the one-story? Was there a loft view on the Province?
Yeah, so one of the benefits of the Florence, there's really two. One is that it has a side entry, front door, which is a little bit different than a lot of the other architectural designs that we have, so it will add to the diversity of the product that we can offer. And to answer your question, the Province was a two-story building only. It always had a first and a second floor. One of the features of the Florence is that it actually can be built as a one-story home, and the buyer can choose to add the loft.
Okay.
So in that sense, it's better. It's not higher.
Thank you.
I think we're ready. I'd entertain a motion to.
I just want, just not to interrupt, but just say that Mark did indicate at design review that they will honor their commitments in the design review board letter and in the planning board permit to still mix up the roof types, the design styles. So these will just be added. Those are not going away, those commitments.
Thanks, Jennifer. All of the conditions and all of the details that we worked through apply to these units, and in no way are we trying to remove any of those commitments.
Okay, and entertain a motion to consider this a minor change.
So moved.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, entertain a motion to add a simplex called bank side and replace the duplex unit Province with Florence.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it. Not to take up any time, because I know you have a busy agenda, but just wanted to mention one thing. At the last meeting, we made one of the minor amendments was to remove the cul-de-sac, which allowed us to preserve an extra three-quarters. Yeah. It's about an acre, okay. A little short of an acre. We've talked with Mr. McDowell, and we are proceeding to put that into restricted land, to add it to the restricted land. So in the near future, we'll be coming back to try to add restricted land to the plan.
Great. Great. And I think you're moving along on your model street a little bit.
We are, yes.
Or did the snow stop you?
No, the snow didn't stop. They just had to clean up a little bit. But.
Okay.
Can I ask you a question, Mark?
Yeah.
Before you go, has any of these already been made?
Not here.
Okay.
No.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. Let's get Paul and
Thank
the crowd.
You. Take care of it. Hello.
Sit on down.
You
We're ready. We'll be ready in a second here. Okay.
Oh, there's.
Okay.
I might put easy.
All sorts of folks. Okay.
A lot more of us coming.
Yeah.
Sort
over there.
Got the auditorium.
Yeah, we should have. Well, we didn't know.
Right.
Sorry that we don't have an awful lot of room in here. We'll, next time we have a hearing for this one, I think we'll plan a little bit better. But welcome to the planning board for everyone. We haven't had a crowd like this in a long while. Let me explain kind of what the procedure is tonight. And basically, we are starting a process, or the, Paul is a developer of 100 acres of land or so off of Chamberlain and Wayland Road, is starting a process. And planning board encourages developers, all developers, to come and talk to us once they get a good idea of what they really want to do. And that would allow the planning board, one, to be aware of what's going on so that it might affect something else that's going on around there, so you kind of figure out what's going on. And it also allows us to give some early direction so that when he's putting together his formal application, that he covers a lot of the bases and maybe doesn't spin his wheels or waste our time going off one direction versus another if we can see some things that just don't work right off. So this is really just the first step of probably a reasonably long process. It takes us a while to approve subdivisions usually. Let me explain the subdivision process because we've got a lot of folks here first. And then we're going to, let me explain. Basically, for a subdivision of land, and we don't do as much of that lately because there's not been as much big chunks of land available in Hopkinton recently, so we've had like one or two a year in the last couple of years, maybe one every other year, and a lot of them are 9-lot subdivisions or 2-lot subdivisions and whatever. But this is the biggest one we've probably seen in, other than Legacy Farms, in 10 years. So, but the process is all the same. Our bylaws, it's open space and landscape development is the bylaw that this is will be submitted under, and that bylaw requires that all subdivisions be submitted in that particular bylaw first. And if we kind of like that one, that's the preferred one for the town. The open space one allows a couple of things. It allows cul-de-sacs of less than 10 units that could be built as part of it. And it also allows a smaller frontage and lot size, with the, and but it requires 50% of the land, I believe, to be remain as open space. And a certain percentage of that has to be upland too, so it just can't be all swamp. It also requires some buffers and a few other things along with it that makes it nominally preferable over the by right type subdivision, which is a conventional subdivision. But if we, as a board, turn down the open space one, which is a special permit, which is a little bit higher standard for the town than the other potential subdivision, can go forward. So anyway, we're starting the process tonight. We're probably and from the process tonight, Paul's going to take some input and feedback. And he'll develop his plans and submit his stuff. And then we will have a series of hearings. And anyone that's within, 400 feet gets, 300 feet gets is a direct abutter. They'll get a legal notice. You'll see it in the newspapers around that is coming up because they know of a lot of interest for this. And then we'll have our public hearings. Our public hearings are structured such that we put together an outline. And on that outline, the town planner, myself, maybe a couple other members of the planning board sometimes put items on the outline. And we have, as one of the second or third items of the outline, additional items that need to be covered, and we allow public input. That series of meetings will be a public hearing. And we encourage the public to speak at the public hearings, and you're listened to very much. This is not the public hearing today, so to kind of set the stage, we're not going to take a lot of input today. Maybe we'll take a little bit if it's going forward, and maybe we'll take a couple of questions, but you will have a lot of opportunity at the public hearing to say your piece and to try to persuade us to make a decision one way or the other through that whole process. But right now, we're just at the very first step of starting the process. And, you know, we have not hired any peer review consultants. We don't have the list of waivers. We don't have an application in front of us. This is just a, hi, how you doing? This is what we're thinking about doing. And you will get some informal comments from members of the board, and we'll make sure we go through that. Typically, we do these for half an hour-ish, maybe a little bit more, but that's what we're going to try to shoot for today. And with that, Paul, Kathy, right. I know you're not strangers to the board. But,
thank you, Kenny. Yeah. My name is Paul Mastriani from REC Hopkinton LLC. I'm an owner and developer. This is Kathy Sherry. She's the controller of REC Hopkins LLC. If you have any problems, questions, direct them. Mostly
right
problems,
to
direct them towards
right
her.
To me.
As you can see, we actually didn't come here, obviously, prepared to bring, you know, the civil engineers, the as far as the traffic engineers. We just literally came just for an informal, just to say hi, show what we're thinking of doing. Would love your input. Obviously, you know, with everything, with the commercial that I've done, I think I've shown that I'd like to, you know, work with the town and work with, you know, all the individuals that we can. So, Kathy, go ahead and Show them what you got.
So if I could spend a couple minutes and we'll give you an overview of the feasibility plan that we submitted. I'm gonna, just going to stand up over here. It might be easier if that's okay.
Great.
All right. So. Am I okay on this?
Yep.
Do you want
to
go on? Okay. So we've submitted for review and informal discussion tonight a feasibility plan for a 34-lot subdivision under the open space landscape preservation special permit. So just to start, in determining the number of lots, we used in general as a guideline the number of lots possible on a conventional subdivision plan, which when we did that plan out, it came out to a minimum of 35 lots. We also calculated the number of possible lots using the OSLP equation that's outlined in the bylaw. That yielded 47 lots. So taking the lesser of the two, we were looking to have a plan that had at least 35 lots on the open space plan. In the end, we were able to carve out 34 lots while still devoting 50% of the total land area to open space. So that's what we're reviewing with you tonight. So that was our starting point. So Paul owns 102 acres between Wayland and Chamberlain. So of the 102 acres, a little over 52 acres would be preserved as open space. That would leave the other 50 acres for the building lots and the roadways. Okay? So starting kind of left to right, we've got Wayland here. We're proposing 13 lots off of Wayland, 21 lots coming off of Chamberlain, and now have a roadway connecting Wayland and Chamberlain. We have minimum 1-acre lots. The lots actually range in size from 1 acre up to about 3 acres. We're planning for four bedroom houses ranging in size from around 3,000 square feet, potentially up to 4,500 square feet. The plan shows private well and septic. We're not ruling out going to the town for potentially for town water, but we did want to make sure that we had a plan that if that was not available, that each lot could support its own well and a private septic system. We have roughly 4,500 feet of new roadway. It's planned out at about 50 feet wide right of way. Sidewalks would be planned for as well. Let's see, no shared driveways. We do have two cul-de-sacs planned off of the Chamberlain, half of the development. They're roughly about 240 feet in length, and we have four houses on each of the two cul-de-sacs, so well within what's allowable under the open space special permit. At this point, we don't believe that we'll require any waivers, at least on the plan as shown. The area, the frontage, the setback requirements all meet the minimum requirements under the open space special permit. All of our lots have at least 100 feet of frontage. Some have more. All the front, side, and rear yard setbacks are at the minimum or better. From a conservation perspective, so we have all structures are outside of the 100-foot buffer, so we have nothing within that 100-foot buffer. No disturbance within the 50-foot buffer. Some lots, we will be going for a permit to cut trees and grade within that 100-foot buffer. And we do have two wetland crossings, one coming off of Wayland and then one on the connecting road between Wayland and Chamberlain that we'll be looking for approval on. So that talks kind of about the lots and the building. From an open space perspective, you're looking at open space all through here as well as all the areas designated as open space here. As I said, it's about 52 acres, of which almost 35 acres are uplands. So this is adjacent and can be connected to the high school. So your high school area is sitting up here. So it's a good amount of open space that can be used for. One of the things that we've noted is there are existing trails running through the property. Our intent would be to relocate trails and extend trails as needed so that it worked within the redesign of the whole property and land area. So that's probably a real high-level overview of the plan we've submitted. So I'll leave it for questions and such.
Board members want to work on the questions, or do you want, I've got about 7 or 8 of them here. Do you want me to start with my 7 or 8?
Please.
Okay.
First, 7.
First of all, I think the open space bylaw requires a 100-foot buffer around the perimeter,
yes.
But that is also something that this board has the authority to waive. We've waived it in small parts other words, but I see on the, I guess it's the east side of the plan, there's not so much buffer indicated in the plan.
You can waive it upon a finding that the buffer of a lesser width would be sufficient to screen and or separate the development from adjacent property, or would allow a historic structure to be preserved, the buffer may be reduced.
So that's the criteria that we're at. And this might be the right thing to do. We're not doing anything today, but that'll be one of the questions that you'll have to be prepared kind of to convince us of that buffer waving in you know, because that is a requirement. And like I said in my preface earlier remarks, a conventional plan is not necessarily better than us without waving the buffer along the high school border and, you know, also the McBride's property that in that complex. So that's the area that. Yeah, the other side you got
it's
a pretty
small, right?
Yeah, I mean it's we're not engineering anything
right.
tonight,
right.
But the,
right.
that is a question. The second one is that the conventional number of lots, you know, will require you to demonstrate that you could build
mm-hmm.
X number of lots on that, and that is one of the first findings this board has to make, is that you can't use open space to do more lots than what you could normally fit in a conventional by right subdivision. My third one is really has to do with traffic. I'm sure we're going to be concerned about that. We might have to look at the closer part of Chamberlain as to whether we need to have two lanes of traffic if this is to be built like that. Or maybe the board has a policy that does not allow large dead ends, but maybe we have to rethink not the policy, but how we kind of put together to preserve safety or whatever. But there's a lot of thinking that has to go along in that, and I'm just mentioning that as a, because I think that's probably what 90% of the people in this room are concerned about. So, I mean, there's got to be a lot of thinking that goes on there, because quite frankly, if this is built and everyone in the room recognize it, that there will be a lot of bypass traffic that will find it on Google Maps and Waves, and you know it's going to change some things. The fourth one I kind of want to bring up is make sure you've got conservation approval faster than not, so that you know because you're crossing a couple of wetlands. I think they have. That's not an automatic with them. That's not my expertise. But I, you know, start with them even faster than us, because we won't finish without them for sure, and they're the ones that have a lot. Next one is trails. I like the idea that we're preserving some of the trail connections, and you know we have this. Berry Acres, we have the high school, we want to somehow get over to the Muse and, you know, try to build a network. This would connect to Center Trail, potentially. I mean, I think it has a lot of good potential features. I see the one trail that looks like it goes right through the swamp. I don't know how wet that area is, you know, but that's a design detail too. But
that's already existing, I think.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
That's existing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so let's see. The last one, or no, not the last one.
Number six.
Mm-hmm. Affordable housing. Our bylaw requires from 2 to 29 either 2 affordable houses for 34. It would be 3, or a payment into that, and you can kind of put through the calculations. A lot of times, people end up with 19 or 29 or 9 or something like that, because it doesn't pay so much to do those extra houses, but you're good enough at that kind of math that you'll, I'm sure, pick out the right way to do it. But that's the flexible community development bylaw that will be applicable to it. We received an email talking about a historic structure, basement foundation. I think everyone really wants to know where on this map it is and whether it's in an area that can be preserved or not. That's something I'm sure everyone will be interested in. I would encourage you to talk with the town about town water. I encourage you to talk to the DPW about town water. I'm sure the fire chief would love to have it sprinkled. And I personally think there's some advantages from an interconnection and some water pressure issues of interconnecting this around the downtown based on water pressure on Hayden Road Street, et cetera. And it would also clean up the dead ends on both, I think Wayland's and Chamberlain both have town water. And if you have a water line with a dead end, basically you get some stagnant water, and your water quality will be improved if it connects through with a water main across there, because the water will be flowing, and particularly if you're at the end of either of those two, things will be better. But I don't know off the top of my head.
I can tell you right now, my water's fine. I'm the last house on the right.
Okay, good.
Never had any trouble.
Okay.
Town water is awesome.
Good. Okay. And then you mentioned, I think, in your opening remarks, Kathy, the 50-foot right-of-way.
Mm-hmm.
We would probably entertain something less than full 50 feet. And maybe your engineers can work with Jennifer and something less. I mean, we literally do not necessarily need a whole 50 feet. You're probably you're at a minimum of 20-foot wide roadway pavement itself, because that's required by the fire chief, et cetera. And maybe it's 22 feet would be kind of, I don't know, right, 20, 22 feet, somewhere in that. But yeah, and you're feel free to talk with Beta beforehand. You'll end up paying for the hours, like you know.
We'd love to do that.
But, but you know, we're more than more than welcome to let them be part of the process as early as it can, because it makes things go better at the other end. Those are my 8 or 9 type points that I had in literally just spending an hour or two looking at the plan. Other questions, comments from members of the planning board?
Context question?
Sure.
Mr. Mastriani mentioned his other projects. Can you, two-part question, can you tell the crowd maybe what your other commercial projects are, and have you done other residential projects in Hopkinton?
I have never done a residential project in Hopkinton. Commercial project that we did was the new with the Muse. With the we sold the land for the 280 apartments, and we did the 33,000 square foot where the 110 grill is. We're looking at it, developing at some point. We've got under agreement the Hopkinton Tennis Fitness and Swim, which again hasn't got off the ground yet, but we're hoping over the next maybe in the next year to be into the ground with that. Obviously, I couldn't do any commercial, with this parcel. But I just thought, instead of just selling it, I thought it would be kind of fun to do a residential, project.
Thank you.
I guess one comment I would make to Mr. Mastriano at the risk of starting off on the wrong foot, hopefully not, because I think you did great work, but I was very disappointed to see the overland utility at the Muse instead of the underground utilities as we require?
It's all going to be underground. That's just temporary.
Oh, that's temporary?
Temporary.
Yeah,
perfect.
I heard that
perfect
recently, and I was kind of surprised that they... But
they just did that so they could work through the winter.
Excellent. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, that'll make that look a lot better.
18 months will be underground.
Okay. Yeah. Perfect.
Very good.
Yeah.
And a procedural question going forward. Chamberlain Road currently is a dead end, but it also historically goes further down into the woods, and it's a nice walkway. Would that original part of Chamberlain Road that's a dead end stay as a nice walkway, or is it half on your property, half on, like, say, town property? And then the second half of that question is, would the Board of Selectmen have to approve that kind of change, or would that be a town meeting kind of change?
It would, if we were to discontinue that part of the Chamberlain that would no longer be needed for a public road, that would end up going through town meeting. And so, yeah.
So is there no access needed down that road?
Well, basically...
So
that,
about halfway down.
That halfway where it connects, you'd have to build more than the cart path that's there.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But there's no need for it. There's no houses down here.
No.
Nope.
Okay.
And that abuts, I believe, the school there, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
A little further out.
And where are we looking at?
Chamberlain.
Upper right side of the map.
I don't even know how long that is. I'm not sure where the rocks are. But
right.
We'd have to go through, like, here,
right,
to where we're
right
coming in.
Right.
But this plan looks like it discontinues that particular trail.
It does.
Yep.
Yeah, because we're coming, the
mm-hmm
Ted's Room property, we're coming down there
right
and then coming in.
Right.
Other question? Yes.
Just a quick question.
Sure.
The addition of possibly 70 more children to the school system, does the school department need to be involved with this? That's almost, what, three classrooms?
Well, I'm sure they're just like every other development, though. They hear about it, and, you know, we're... But typically it's not a...
Well, I mean, we made a point of legacy to prevent adding to the school system if we could. I don't know if there's a delineation between what happened there.
Well, legacy was more of a special deal because we, the town, entered into an agreement to rezone some land, and we put a lot of different conditions on this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, the town could maybe negotiate with a different type of housing if we wanted to go through the town meeting and if he wanted to go through that whole hassle, but that would be up to him to propose to do something much different and try to enter into an agreement. You know, right now our bylaw, because we have met our 10%, we no longer allow garden apartments, which is the condo bylaw, as a right through all the parts.
Mr. Chair, just a quick question.
Yeah.
The shading, the key, is it by elevation, the land, the white, the green, the lighting?
No.
White is uplands, the yellow is the 100-foot buffer, the line going
okay
through at 50-foot, and then the wetlands in green.
And inclusively, to the chair?
Yeah, go ahead.
Inclusively, you're including the wetland as the 50%.
Correct.
Open space,
exactly. So there's 52 acres. It's a combination of wetlands and uplands. And then a certain percentage of that has to be uplands, as Ken pointed out at the beginning of the meeting. So we've got 35 out of the 52. So it's a higher percentage than what's minimally required.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
From that type of the bylaw, I think they meet most of the requirements.
Kathy, just a quick clarification question. You've got that one little parcel, circle. Does that mean anything there, or is it just...
We believe it's just upland.
Okay.
Yes.
We were asking that before. I'm like, what is that?
It's upland.
Right. It's a what?
I said,
what
is that?
It's just upland.
It's a circle.
That I thought that was supposed to be if we were going to do the...
Yeah.
No, that was going to be if we were to do the septic.
Because
we were looking at doing a septic that they were shared septic.
Community septic.
Mm-hmm. Community, and that's why we didn't take that out.
One more comment for the board.
Yeah, go.
Chair. We often hear that we have a lot of construction going on in town, and you're responsible for part of it. And this is something to think about. How do we handle not overbuilding and building responsibly. And so far, we see some positive things here, and we see some things that are very questionable. But I just like to say I hope you work with the neighborhood that is concerned and do the right thing, like you do.
I think Mr. Mastroianni has done that consistently on his projects, and as we've expressed to some of the individuals here, whether it's trails, whether it's compromise, we're certainly open to hearing what we can do.
Okay, other members of the board, questions, comments? Have we kind of gone through the highlights, and that's kind of all we're, you know, this is very preliminary, first look. Lot to come. Oh, what's your kind of timing for maybe putting an application in? I mean,
within the next 30 to 60.
30 to 60 days, we should be set to.
We're doing a traffic study too. I just want to make sure that's before we have the first meeting. We want to make sure the traffic study, is done.
Yeah, there's some requirements of having that done during the school year, I believe, and things like that. And I think you're going to have to look how it ends. Enters in and out at both of the major routes, obviously, but maybe you can work with Beta to put some reasonable bounds on what that is. John?
The chair. And I think going back to the traffic study, I think one of my major concerns is the impact of through traffic or even these additional, both on Chamberlain and Whalen and at the major intersections. I have at Chamberlain and Hayden Row, so close to where the school is, et cetera, really making sure we're not adding additional problems that can't be taken care of at that intersection is going to be a particular concern.
Okay.
Just one quick question. Yeah. Size of the houses, square footage, what are you ranging?
I think she had mentioned
three,
that.
Sorry, I missed it.
Around 3,000.
Okay, 3, thank 000. You.
Up to probably 4,500.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. At the risk of prolonging this, I'm going to ask for a couple of comments from the public.
I would like to just ask.
A question.
Yeah. If I may.
Go ahead.
With regards to the existing neighborhoods associated to that, do these houses mass out the neighborhoods in size?
Are they bigger?
Quite bigger, right?
I would say on an average they're definitely bigger. I don't know which percentage, but there's some houses on Chamberlain that are, I would assume, around 3,000 square feet at all, or 3,500, but again, they're probably a little bit bigger than.
We're not looking to build mansions.
Not building McMansions. I don't want to do that. I actually like 28 to 32. So it just depends on, what the demand is.
Sure. I just wanted to bring that to the surface so that the residents and stuff.
Okay. Jane?
Jane Moran, chair of the Upper Charlesville Committee. It's nice to see your presentation. And I would just like to reconfirm that we are 100% behind trails throughout Hopkinton. We have yet, as an Upper Charles Trail group, decided where the final trail is going to go, from Milford to connect to the Central Trail to Ashland. However, no matter where that trail ends up going, we would most definitely be interested in working with you in the planning board to at least, at a minimum, come up with spur trails throughout your property. And I think that's about enough to say.
Okay. Great.
We're definitely open to that. And yes, we'd like to pursue it.
Yes, sir.
Hi, Don Gavin from 14 Whalen Road. You had mentioned dead end streets. I kind of like the term cul-de-sac rather than dead end. But you also said it was a policy. Is it a policy or is it a regulation regarding your restrictions on cul-de-sacs, lengths of cul-de-sacs? So I really want this board. I don't care about the number of homes, selfishly speaking, and I'm not speaking for anyone other than me. I'd want two cul-de-sacs. I think if it works for the builder, it certainly works for me and Wayland Road, because that is my number one concern, is you are not going to, there's just going to be no one going up to Pleasant Street anymore. Anyone who wants to access EMC Park, anyone who wants to access that new middle school or that new elementary school is going to be going down Wayland Road, up this new street, connecting to Chamberlain. And it's going to be an overwhelming overload of vehicles. So I guess, that was a little bit of a speech, but my question was, is it an actual regulation here about the length of the streets, or can this board work with it? Because you mentioned policy, which is different than a regulation.
It is. The open space development allows, which is the bylaw that this would be built under, perhaps, allows 10 lots on a cul-de-sac.
Of 1,000 feet?
Of less than 1,000 feet. So basically, kind of what I'm seeing here, that doesn't work. We also don't allow a cul-de-sac on top of a cul-de-sac. Wayland Road and Chamberlain are all already beyond that 10 lot, built years before we even had those type of bylaws in process. A conventional subdivision will only allow a cul-de-sac of, is it 900 feet?
500 feet.
And it requires exceptional circumstances to be there. Sometimes exceptional circumstances have been met by a large donation of land to the town of Hopkinton, or there's some other exceptional circumstances of maybe topography, etc. But usually it's a large gift to the town of Hopkinton for a cul-de-sac.
52 acres is a large gift.
Yeah. Well, this is an open space. That's part of the, you know, we extract that as part of the.
How long is the cul-de-sac?
So the board has discretion, though, is what I'm hearing. The board has sounds like the board has discretion.
We have limited discretion, but if you would put those number of feet on, I don't think they work terribly well here, but, you know, there might be another solution. I don't know. But, you know, we've got to let the engineers go play with it.
I think their discretion is limited to what are exceptional circumstances and what isn't. So not whether or not the actual cul-de-sac, because the cul-de-sac is not allowed.
Well, is safety an exceptional circumstance?
To my knowledge, that's never been considered an exceptional circumstance.
The fire chief and the police chief would usually testify before this board saying that a through road actually makes it safer for having two exits and entrances. It's a lot of that. Their safety concern is you being the 10th house down the end, and the tree comes and it blocks it down, or, you know, there's a police incident or something like that. They want to be able to get to things from both ends, and that's part of the reason. Another issue on cul-de-sacs from a planning standpoint, while a lot of people like to live on cul-de-sacs, and I appreciate that very much, from a planning standpoint, connectivity is usually something that the town is looking for. And I'm not going to pass judgment on that or not. Carol?
Is it possible to allow emergency access only? Fire access?
That might be something that should be explored.
I have one other question, if
mm-hmm.
I can.
Sure.
If you have to do it this way, and you're going to send that kind of traffic down Chamberlain Street, is the developer responsible for making Chamberlain Street and Wayland Street adequate for the traffic that they're going to generate, even though that's outside their development?
The board would have to make a judgment on that, but I've always had the policy, if you break it, you fix it. But that's just my one member of the nine members here.
Does Chamberlain Street would require a great deal of...
I said, Chamberlain, if you were going to put through traffic through there, it needs two safe lanes. But that's just observations, having gone down to the end a couple of times in my life. Any other quick questions? Because we've got a lot of other work to do tonight. Yes, sir.
I was just curious, is there a requirement that the road be paved?
He is... I don't think there's a requirement that this board would require the road be paved because, you know, the town would be accepting this road. And, you know, quite frankly, nobody wants to live on a gravel road.
Well, maybe something in the middle. Maybe you pave it. Again, if the board, maybe that becomes narrower or maybe not as improved. Again, I'm just, I don't really know, but could look at that.
You know, you end up with a maintenance liability. But I don't know. It's something we might think about, parts of it. I don't know.
One additional question?
Sure, go ahead.
Any consideration for how, for what happens at the current end of the center trail at Chamberlain Street? I guess I'm curious, right now there's a lot of runners. The high school cross-country team uses it. The middle school cross-country team uses it. There's people that run in the morning on it. If this becomes a two-way street, does that affect usage of that trail?
Well, it is a two-way street on Chamberlain. It's just a dead end. If I may, my understanding, and John Ritz can probably say a little bit more about it, but that part of the trail continues, and then it would, I'm assuming, move around the two homes that would be on the way of that path right now. So that's my best guess. And
obviously, there'll be up to new planning in the trail if things are blocking it off. I mean, you know, might be a sidewalk for part of it. I don't know. I mean, there's. I'm not going to presume what the engineering solutions could be.
Right.
Okay.
I have a question. Didn't we a few years ago vote?
Oh, name, please.
Oh, I'm sorry, Nancy Baker Fowler. I'm on Nicholas Road. Okay. Didn't we vote Chamberlain as a scenic roadway a few years back at town meeting?
Yes.
And what does that involve? I thought we couldn't widen it anymore.
No, that just means they need approval to remove stone walls or cut down trees of this board.
My earlier question.
And usually means that we'd also probably require, when we normally let a lot of people cut down trees to access their property, but at that point they have to replant something, you know, that in years will maybe make up for a big tree. Okay. We've got a lot of things we've got to get done yet today.
Thank you, everybody, for coming. Yeah, we all appreciate that.
And
we'll
hope to see you all at the real hearing, which will be coming
at the high school.
Yes.
Yep.
To hear about those utility poles.
See that? You're all mad at me, and I had them fixed already.
Give you the benefit of the doubt, so that was good.
Good job, Paul.
Okay.
Hey, you're on my good side now.
Thank you.
Take care.
Okay, moving right along. Next item. Next item for discussion. 79 Hayden Row is coming back to us. After they've gone through the Board of Appeals and successfully gone through that process. They'll be at our next meeting. However, we need an extension of the time to provide. For the extension of the time. So we've received a email from the architect, Richard Brousseau, and we need to approve the request for an extension of time for the planning board to file their decision with the town clerk, February 6, 2017. I entertain a motion to do that.
So moved.
Second somewhere?
Second.
Okay, further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone
Nay.
Abstain?
Okay.
You're abstaining?
I'm saying no.
You're saying no? Okay. Motion carried. Okay. Now we're at the key one, which is the master plan. Let's see, we're at 9 right now. Let's see. Okay, my goal for the master plan is to discuss all the changes that Elaine put into it, and we'll try to go through that quickly. And then if we're happy with where the words are, I mean, we can easily delete some things and make some minor changes out.
I'm just going to close the door.
The end would be a motion, because the implementation plan at the back was kind of assigned by Elaine, and where she's assigned it to, say, the Board of Selectmen or the Parks and Rec. I think before we publish that with those people's name on it, we ought to go talk to those committees to make sure they've accepted the responsibility for their implementation. I mean, so basically we would, maybe a motion that would be in order at the end, if we're so there, to approve the wording of the document subject to verification from all those people in the implementation plan, of which we have quite a few of them, are willing to take it on. So I'm not sure how my pages correlate with the one that she passed out, but because I had ones done with, I had one printed out of the, all the colored ones. But my first one was on page 16. So let me just try to lead through this thing here. And 16 was, I think, a pretty minimal one, if I remember. Oh, now, this is the area that we got input from the school superintendent about the increased number of students. So we've just changed that, and which is a fairly large change, but basically they're looking at a total of 316 more students to be enrolled in the district by 2026. So basically there's some changes for that.
So we just added 70 more. well, if it, I mean, looking forward.
Well, stay focused. Now, their format for their numbers assumes in their projection that Hopkinton builds. I might argue that if they take their assumption of us building based on our last 5 years and carry it forward, they might be having a harder, bigger number.
Too big.
They may be too big.
Okay.
Because I see there aren't 34 more of these being built around. You know, there just isn't land to kind of do that.
I see.
It all gets into the methodology. I always thought that NASDAQ did a really poor job of underestimating the number of students, and we kind of provided some data to the school committee, and finally they got through there. So this, does anyone have any problems with the word changes on in talking about school kids? And there was a minor change to the vacant land by zoning district, which just added a 2015 to that.
So sorry, what are the numbers I'm seeing here? 1671 additional K-12 students?
Yep.
So is that the new number, or do we know?
Yes, that's the changes we're talking about.
Okay.
K-12, right?
Yeah. Okay, then on page 18, and stop me if you have problems with the wording. 18 and 19, we have a new paragraph called General Growth and Development. And we had something about aging population, and I think that came from...
I think a lot of that came from the senior center.
Yeah. And I think... So basically those are kind of a little bit of general, but a lot of the aging population came from the senior center. So,
I have an issue with the word many in the community.
Yeah.
We're
just at the start of the very bottom.
Okay.
On the page under the general growth and development, it says many in the community. Is that a majority of the community? Is that?
Yeah. I don't
know if that's a tail wagging a dog.
A wasn't here at your public hearing, and B, Elaine wrote it, so I don't know.
I think we might have gotten that from that one person that had worry about the growth? Remember we had the one person that kind of talked about that?
Yes, I do. Ironic, she lives on Sanctuary Lane.
Oh, okay.
The new development there. Yeah. I thought that was funny.
Okay. So maybe we ought to change.
Yeah, I mean, I
recommend change many to some.
It's so generically.
Yeah, it's very vague.
How about sentiments?
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't give a number?
There are some.
Sentiments in the community?
There are sentiments in the community?
I think that my concern in making it seem too broad is that I don't think there is a huge number that have expressed a desire to stop building and development.
Building and development is a tough...
Right. I think to control building and development is a different issue. But if you're using stop building and development, it's a small number. But it has been expressed that there are some people who want to stop.
So why don't we just change stop to control and then
just leave the rest the way it is?
Yes.
Sure. Yeah.
Okay.
That sounds good.
Good catch.
Stop to control.
Well,
many in the community have expressed a desire to control building and development and to preserve more space.
Yep.
Right.
I like the way it's originally worded because,
Well, we can't quantify many.
Not at this point, no.
I don't think this board agrees with stop building and development. We want to just do it the right way.
Desire to stop sort of must be tempered with a desire of property owners. So we say a fair and even.
What's the stop word though?
Well, we got
at the beginning.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that's not the second one.
No. This one. Instead of stop, let's say control.
To Frank's point, though, I think I understand what he's saying. Is like you're not saying you've expressed a desire to stop building.
No, but we're approving this.
Right.
Right, but that has been a sentiment in town. I've only been here 18 months, and I've heard it, that there is a desire to stop building and development. But if you read the rest of the paragraph, to Frank's point, it does say the desire to stop development must be tempered with the desire of property owners to sell their land for development and realize a return on investment. So it does, get into, what your actual abilities are in regards to that action. Do you know what I'm saying?
I agree. Agreed, but also what happens in there, though, is that when we start off with that people are that have a desire, express desire to stop, we all know that people are voicing their opinion on the growth aspect of the town,
mm-hmm.
and they're concerned about how fast it is growing,
mm-hmm.
and they do want to slow it down. So when we bring in the word stop right at the beginning, it throws up a red flag for everybody to start to argue.
Do we want to change the word to control and stop in the second paragraph, the desire to control development?
Yes, or something there similar.
Just using the word control.
It's just stop.
Yeah. Because if we have a stop, then there'll be oppositionals that'll just run right at us.
Okay.
Well,
good catch.
I know what you're saying, but I still think you're missing the point of the paragraph.
No, but
the paragraph isn't saying that the planning board supports stopping development. That's
right.
Not what the paragraph is saying.
No,
right.
But people are going to construe it that way, I think. Just from reading it and going to town meeting, they might breeze through rather than read the whole thing.
This doesn't go to town meeting, but it could be used as an argument in a town meeting.
Right.
But I think if you actually stop people and ask them, do you want to stop, they'll come back, I don't really want to stop.
Right.
Control.
Right.
No, so, but in the event a developer gets turned down, he can throw this in our face. You said you want to stop it in your own charter.
Right.
We just had a room full of people that would stop that development.
Well, they want to control it.
Well, that's because of their street.
I think they want to control it.
But they didn't seem too adamant. Yes.
Oh. Never mind. Okay. I think control works better.
It does.
We have to have some kind of compromise.
Two places.
I agree.
Manage.
Manage is good.
You like manage
better? Yeah, manage.
Either one.
Control is...
We could even say
both the same thing.
You could even say limit.
Limits better than stop.
I'm just saying, limits better than stop. If
control.
You look at
control
it,
control better, manage better.
Manage is better. Manage is better than control. But control works.
All those want manage, raise your hand. Okay.
It's just we need a majority.
Can we stop this discussion? Any in the community express a desire to
control
manage
works.
Building and
what?
Development? Is that what we're saying?
Yeah. Use the word manage. Two places.
Where's the second place?
It's on the top of the next page.
Yeah.
The desire to manage development must be tempered with the desire of to sell our land and realize it to return on investment.
Okay.
Aging population, that just seems like it's more fact. Ensuring is, I didn't quite understand how we get a high walkability score, but.
I didn't understand that either, but.
All about Ash Street.
We surpassed Boston. Boston's not very walkable, but Hopkinton is.
Okay.
Maybe
because of the trails.
We get sidewalks.
That brings up something that I had noticed, Ken, that I'd like to bring to your attention.
Yeah, go ahead.
Because of this master plan. It's funny because after we had discussed about busing or transportation throughout the town, picking up people, remember our last meeting, we all discussed something about that. I saw a trolley car bus go by, and I thought the antiquation of that trolley in the town would be absolutely adorable to transport people, maybe to trails and things like that. So I'm wondering if we can't find a space for that somewhere in here.
Well, I think we had some public transportation, but let's keep going through the transportation clause.
Yeah.
Let's focus where we're at. Okay, on the next page, we added on to the action plan for land use goals. One was to convert the hardscape to landscape in downtown. The second was a traffic sign audit. I think these came from the Historic Commission. The planning board should require development applicants to identify what town services are required for new proposed development. I think that was more of a...
What number is that, Ken?
10. And that's basically giving a report on a semi-annual business to the town manager for capital and budgeting, whatever. We do a similar report occasionally to the school committee on what we see the forecast. I know I've been invited a couple times to speak to them. And then the last is assess area needs in transportation, outdoor spaces, building, et cetera.
Where are you on?
It's page 20.
20.
That whole what you mean, number 11, Ken? The transportation?
11, yep.
Access needs to areas including transportation, outdoor spaces, buildings, and communication.
Okay.
So that brings me back to that. But go ahead.
Yes. So does anyone have problems with those as action plans? Hearing none, we can move along. So that's page 20. 27 is the next page that had some additional stuff.
Did anybody have anything in between those pages?
If they do, speak up. 27 is really...
Chair,
yeah.
And I hate to jump back.
Okay, go ahead.
On page 19, wasn't there a comment that the use of old should be replaced by senior?
And no, it was...
old homes.
Yeah, there was a discussion.
It's right, stuff. I don't want to be stuck in the back.
The senior center did. I'll ask that question because they did make a note about what it should be. We had, I think, an elderly, and they wanted something else.
And I think old is also might fall into that. Just as
which
senior population has traditionally been, replaced.
Okay.
However, the senior population is growing is.
Which one are we looking at?
Under aging population on page 19.
Where we have older in line one and older in line three.
Oh, so you're saying
right here, older.
However, the older population is growing a baby booming residence age.
Hopkinton's mature.
Okay.
population.
Well, senior is the current.
No, that makes sense.
Senior, okay.
Would that fit in there, though, under the verbiage?
Sure.
I'm sorry, what did I miss?
Change senior, older to senior?
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay, going back to 27, good catch, John. I think this has to do with a change in open land ownership, and that just basically updates the stats.
To 2016, yeah, from 2014, yep.
Okay, then on the next page, we're talking about historic districts and CPA, which was a couple comments to the hearings. The only question I had is on the last part of the CPA area, you said something through 2016, the town purchased 275 acres of open space with CPA funds and implemented several historic preservation, and I'd like to add, and recreation. We did Sandy Beach, and we did a few, we did
yes.
Turf fields, I believe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that kind of, and you know, this open space would be the trail money that we spent, et cetera. So anyway, and recreation is broad enough to add that onto it. Anyone else have any other questions about districts and stuff? I think we got that from the historic folks. And then on the page 31, we are basically added an addition to preserve the downtown streetscape as the town becomes more developed and downtown lots more desirable. Study the expansion of the Hopkinton District Historic District, working with property owners and town boards. And I think we gave that to the historic ones. I have a feeling that any owner in downtown that would add their house to or their place to it, you know, good luck on that one. Like,
real good luck.
Would you like to put some limitations on your house?
But it does say work with, et cetera. So, does anyone have a problem with including that one in? Okay. 49 is the next page that I have gotten something in.
What did you say, 49?
49. And we're talking.
Number 7.
Yeah. This is getting rid of the onerous type thing. I think it just got reworded a little bit.
What number, please?
7.
Diversify the tax rate. The town should achieve a tax base of 80-20, and that should probably be a period. It does not appear that it is necessary to rezone residential land to achieve this goal because it's more about the quality or the value of commercial development rather than the quantity.
What are we at now?
I want to say 17%. So that's close. Off the top of my head.
Close, right?
Okay, seeing no objection to page 49, speak up if you're not happy. 52 had a minor typo, will begin, it's because construction's already began, so
yeah.
We updated that. And then 53.
What did you change on 52, Ken?
52.
You don't have the highlights in red?
No, I don't.
They have a clean copy because they have the hard copy.
There's a construction will began in 2016 on the.
Okay.
On the,
you guys don't have the crossed off words either.
No, nothing.
Geez, you really got shafted.
No,
whatever she
put said.
I'm just kidding.
The red line was electronic and the hard copies were clean.
She did say that.
I did say that.
Okay.
If you wanted hard copies red lined, you should have let me know.
Okay.
Trying to convert everybody to electronic.
Okay, and then the page 53, the last paragraph, we got the word older population. Is that I think is okay there.
Yeah, I think there, but you're doing a comparison.
Yes.
Yeah, you're not talking about a group of people being old.
Right.
The growth of an older population and an increase in medical calls. And then construction began in 2016 on the library and the senior center. We, I think, included all of their words, which talk about, got rid of the word elderly.
Right, that. That's where they changed it, mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so that's, and then on the next page, which is 54, we talked, we've changed a little bit about awards for the public schools. We didn't quite go as strongly because we updated it, but we still gave. And then we talked about number of classrooms on page 55. And that was just really just additional data. New elementary schools under construction.
Isn't the
83,000
going to
change if we add questions?
The which?
I think as of right now, that's what it is. So we're not.
You might. We might add another line at the end of that that says already the town's looking to expand that school. It is a town meeting.
For the elementary, right?
Yeah.
The new one?
Hayden Row.
Do you want to do that?
Yeah, do you really want to open that up?
But just well, it's not. It's in front of the voters on the 30th of January.
It's on the news.
It's yeah, made the front page of. Front page of the news today. It's a Warren article on the thing. We'll talk about it later. Yeah, let's add a.
Well, let's not say already though.
Yeah.
Let's phrase it better.
Let's.
The new school's too small.
Yes, that's what they said.
They haven't built yet.
Control population.
Oh wow.
Control. We'll talk about it in more detail later here, and then we had the question about the dog park, so we added a paragraph on 60. On
56
to talk about dogs. 59 is the next page, which
what, can I ask you what was yeah. What was changed on the dog park?
The whole paragraph.
Oh, we just added it all.
Okay.
It's all new.
Yep. I got it. Okay. It's bold faced on dog
yep.
Park.
Yep.
That's how I
haven't seen any updates on 59.
Yeah,
okay.
59, they changed some data in the table. Oh, there's more data in there, and
we have that. We actually had that on the hard copy, right?
Yeah, we had that in the hard copy. My copy's already got a change because I got it late today. And we also need a number pending in the education area.
Could I ask you to repeat that?
Nolan's asked them for that several times and has not received it.
Can I ask you to repeat that, please, for clarity?
There is.
You see the table on the top of page 59?
Yep.
You see this table right here?
Oh, okay.
This data ended up going in it.
All right. Has that been updated yet or not?
Yes.
It has.
Yeah. It's just data.
Okay. Do we
but we don't have anything from the school department. Maybe we can try one more time.
Hold on just a second. I want to go back. Do we give a total for that? Town government. We don't. Do we say the total? Or we have asking everybody to add up all the budget. To
we ask everyone to add it up because I'm not.
Yeah.
Sure.
Did we? Did we? What is our current budget annually now?
Add it up. 42, 44, 47, 50, 51, like 52 million.
It's actually 70 something. So
yeah, you're right. It's 70.
Yeah.
This talks about.
I have some numbers.
This talks about budget. I don't think.
Doesn't include like debt service.
Right. There's a bunch
stuff.
Of other stuff
okay.
That's not in there.
A bunch of,
so it's closer to 90, 100?
No, I don't think it's that high.
No, it's like 70, like.
Yep. Okay, on page 60, we talked about charter, and they just kind of talked about, they kind of updated the words. There's one new paragraph at the top of page 61. It talks about master plan recommendations can be implemented. Where did that one come from? Was that from the town manager?
That I don't know. First I seen it.
Is this at the top of the page?
Basically, it says we got to work together for common goals.
Maybe it was Elaine's idea.
What?
Maybe it was Elaine's idea.
Whatever.
We'll get
some nice
charter. Well, no, we didn't. Didn't we discuss that on our last meeting when Elaine was covering?
Yeah, I think we did.
I think we did, too.
Well, we can look at the minutes, which we'll do shortly, but because we happen to have the minutes for that meeting. And then on page 63, there's a sustainability that I'm not sure who we added to, that I'd give a credit for Frank on that one.
Probably Frank.
I think Elaine wrote this, though.
I'm sure she did.
She probably wrote it, but you probably had asked her to do a paragraph of sustainability.
Oh, yeah, right. Come on, this is your
I was part of that.
Yep.
Did you get
okay.
You have those?
You changed your name. I did a solo, Frank.
It looks kind of nice.
Yep.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Then I'm going to we added goals. We changed 18. This is on page 65. Create bicycle and pedestrian trails. Connect trails to neighborhoods. Mm-hmm. Coordinate trail development. Work with developers to create trails and
just
new
like
developments.
Tonight, just like tonight.
Monitor and plan for potential impact of school enrollment across the district. That's a new one. And then develop policies to achieve long-term sustainability and efficiency, et cetera.
It
all seemed like pretty nice stuff to do after we got through it. Okay, I'm trying to squeeze through here. I think the next one is... Then we're going to transportation.
Okay.
And
I would like to make a motion to add that consideration for a trolley for the town.
Well, we are part of this Metro West Transit Authority. They are the one that gets the funding for it.
Yep.
Unless you wanted to pay out of your taxpayer money for town employee to drive a trolley and pay for the trolley, the only way you get the state to pay for it, and that's not cheap, is through this regional transit authority.
And what would you consider not cheap?
A couple hundred thousand a year.
For a driver?
Well, driver or truck,
insurance.
Maintenance,
insurance.
Most insurance.
Diesel.
Wouldn't that be paid for if the trolley charged a stipend for movement?
None of these regional things make a dime's worth of money.
Well, and like Westboro has its own shuttle, but we don't have enough. We wouldn't have enough ridership to make it
right.
To work. Where Westboro has a lot of businesses that will use it, and then that supports their daytime activity too. We don't have enough. We wouldn't have enough ridership in Hopkinton.
So no, but we don't even know if there's a metrics for that, right?
Can I give you actual data? No, but from my experience, or my planning professional knowledge, I can tell you that we don't have enough.
Well, if we have never applied it, then we never know the answer to that.
Okay.
I think it's a good idea, but I think it's a more complex idea than what we can plan.
Well, I'm suggesting it because it's going in front of the town meeting.
This isn't,
but the concept is, right? The whole master plan concept.
You have the regional transport right on the bottom of.
Through the chair.
Yeah.
Just some experience, having been involved in establishing a shuttle service in Canton. Royale Street in Canton has a population, or had a population of about 7,000 employees. And running a shuttle to the 128 train station elicited about a total of 50 or 60 people a day. And just running that basically from 7 to 9 and 4 to 6 was about $140,000 for the bus, the insurance, the driver, etc.
Annual.
So it's a lot of money for 4 hours a day.
Was there a fee?
The only way they could do it is the companies had to kick it up. There was no way it could sustain itself.
I see. Well, thank you for that.
And we do have a goal that says encourage residents and employers to promote and use public transportation, carpooling, and ride sharing. Considering working with other towns in the region to encourage TDM practices as part of the review process for major and development projects. So that kind of stuff is in there. So if we had, like, you know, if we wanted to work with Dell Technologies or another business and see if they'd be willing to start something, I don't necessarily think putting, you know, create a trolley program, it needs to be in the master plan, but we have the concept.
That's a good idea, yeah.
Do you know what I
mean?
It's already in there.
Yep.
Those are things that we can work on.
Right. Thank you.
Okay. The next one is on page 72.
Can you go to page 70 first?
Sure.
Maybe it's just me, but at first it took me a long time to tell that this was table wrapped around to the bottom there. And I understand what they're trying to do with the shading with every other line, but should we maybe just shade the headers? Because see how it's 2005 through 2009 in the top section, 2010 to 2014.
Okay.
I don't know. I just visually, I don't know if we could do something better on that to make it a little more readable.
Maybe it's the fact that it goes 5, 6, 7, 8, 9,
yeah.
And then
yeah.
It looks like
it's
it should be 1.
I first thought, like, where is 2010? Where's 2011? Well,
yeah,
behind.
You get lost.
But anyway, just to...
Well, the top of it says 2005 dash, and there's no end year, so that could be one table.
Right.
The second table could be...
If you took the vertical lines off between the top and the bottom, it would work better.
That's right.
Just make it nice.
Okay.
it's a good observation.
What do you got next, Ken?
72 just had one additional space. That's not a big deal. We just found a typo, obviously. 74 is the next one. We have public transportation reflects the needs of the citizens. I believe this is from our senior center folks.
Yes.
And then on 74.
Wait a minute. Back to 72, please, Ken.
Yep.
Also, the implementation of the, on the bottom paragraph, also the implementation of the all-electronic tolling system.
Mm-hmm.
Along the entire length of I-90, what is that inferring to us as far as we've got something to do with that?
No.
Where are you seeing that? Sorry.
On the bottom page of 72.
Yep. Start the sentence off.
Just saying because our fire department responds to accidents on that part of the highway will affect their response time.
Yeah, I think it's going to improve it. It already, if you go to Boston, you save 12 minutes from 495 into Boston. It's, and those are nice. That's 12 minutes each way too.
Yeah, and then it doesn't
and
bottleneck.
And worst times, it's even less more than that. Going to page 75. 75 talks about our sidewalks and it adds Holt Street to it. There was discussion.
That was the president, I think, who had that.
There was somebody that had that. That is not what we had voted for before, but it's. Do we want to include that into the list here or not?
I personally would like to even go back to. I know we put priorities for Hayden Row because of the new school and to get to the west part of town as well, and that's going to be challenging under the highway, but I mean, I would like to see something out Woodville Way as well. I mean, how do we.
Well,
I was just saying, just if we're going to have some kind of a plan. I wouldn't even know if I would put future sidewalks in here.
Well, it's
I mean, that's a whole can of worms that people want sidewalks and they're where they want them in the section of town.
If anything, wouldn't you want to go back to what the survey said?
Holt was on the survey.
I don't think it was very high.
Wasn't
high.
No, that one gentleman had a problem with it because of the bus or the mailman or something.
Yeah.
I don't recall. It was an issue.
So is the consensus to take Holt out of here?
That's what we'll deal with it this year.
And, you know, this is an area where it's going to get worked upon over,
right,
you know, I think
it's going to change every year. You do
how about if we add a
why don't we
add something that talks about continuing to do a updated survey?
And why don't we talk about our successes, what we've already done?
Yeah, the new sidewalks on Ash Street, West Main, and Wolf Street.
Okay.
Yeah, it's mentioned up top.
So maybe an item F would be.
Well, they do have to have a survey right there too.
Yep. Continue to survey needs.
Recommendations.
And develop recommendations for additional sidewalks.
And on topic, Ken?
Yeah.
Look at Milford bike trail passageway underneath 195. They built up the
we talked about that, right, Cliff?
They built up that wall.
About that as a possibility for going under
135. Right.
Yeah.
Yep.
So I don't know if maybe that would solve the problem underneath 195.
It would solve one problem. The real problem that we have, as opposed to Milford, is they basically have a stoplight at least on one of those accesses to get across there, and that makes it a lot more safe than.
Think about the entrance and exit ramps as well. I think is what Ken is saying.
Yeah.
People have to get across there.
But I'm not. But I'm not saying that, you know, it can't be done.
Right.
Yeah.
It's just.
Yeah.
Additional.
Okay.
So, Mr. Chairman, just the point of the recommendation, I think would be that the new sidewalks should be constructed as follows. Does that mean we're locked into those three?
Well, right now, John Westerling is taking our written recommendations to him and starting to price them out.
Okay.
Because he had some engineering money. So, I think we are locked in.
Okay. But I think he's going to town meeting in May with an actual warrant article for these specific recommendations.
Yeah, for construction money.
Yes.
Okay, 76 talks about the do not block problem with Reserve Street in the action plan. Then we get to the implementation plan. What I worry about here is there's no timelines and there's no additional resources needed type thing. So we should pass this out to all the people that we're about to give primary responsibility and ask for their input on timelines and additional resources.
Yeah, I agree.
Because this is, I think, something that Norman was trying to push, and I think it was Norman really wanted, and Elaine wanted to get the implementation thing going, which I think will make it a lot, potentially that this document will actually be worth more than the last one was, because people will be tasked with that.
So can you just explain this a little bit more? Like, what do the shaded ones mean, and why is there LU numbers and then other numbers?
I think they're shaded just because their LU would be the land use number one.
Okay.
And then the next, the green color, NCO, would be
Natural
Cultural and Open Space Resources. And then probably the next one is Housing and Development.
According to the index.
Could we put a what do they call them on a map to tell them what each thing is?
Key code?
Key code, yes, thank you.
Well, maybe you put down which, at the beginning of each of these shaded things, what section they came from. Entertain a motion to submit this to the motion to approve the draft as written and to submit it to those people that have been identified for primary responsibility to give input on timeline and additional or new resources needed.
So moved.
Okay. Moved and seconded. Further discussion.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah.
So do you want to see it back when those people give input, or?
Yes. We got to set a deadline for them for like a 3 weeks from now, 4 weeks from now.
So you want it back for like your first meeting in February?
That would be nice. Whether we'll get it or not.
And which
I
will not be yet.
Oh.
Vacation again?
Okay. So there's motion on the floor. Kobe's got it, I think.
Yep.
So all those in favor say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And it's been a long time in coming, and we're at the last little bit. Okay. What's next on that?
Goals.
Let's take goals at the end here. Let's get some of these other ones accomplished quick. The 81P plan for 151 Hayden Row. Basically, we signed this plan already. It's the same plan as before. He just didn't record it in time, and they're worrying about the mortgage, and they had all sorts of difficulty with Historic Commission, Massachusetts Historic Commission, just as Jennifer said they would. And
oh, I know.
Who do you know?
And so anyway.
What was the concern?
Well, remember I had proposed a historic restriction.
Yep.
That was similar to the one that Mass Historic uses.
Correct.
And they wanted to change it.
They wanted to make their own.
So Mass Historic changed it back.
Okay.
Basically.
Okay.
So they didn't record it yet. They're closing. They're supposed to close next Tuesday. But they still feel like that won't be enough time for them. It needs to be recorded by the 25th. They feel like that still won't be enough time. So just to cover themselves, they wanted a new plan signed to give them another 6 months. So.
And you have collected $100 from them?
I did got a new fee and a new application and everything.
So, so we're a revenue source for the town today.
We can put that in the charter.
So I just need two signatures.
Wait, for A&R, do we have to vote first? Or
Motion to sign the A&R plan.
Motion.
Moved and seconded. How do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Nay.
Okay. Okay. Let me try to. Does anyone have any comments to the minutes for November 7th, November 21st, and December 5th?
Yes.
Okay. Which one do you have comments on?
Hold on.
Okay. We will take them up separately then.
I think I have.
We need one more signature.
Matt's got it.
Matt got it.
You got to spin it, Matt.
Call that CrossFit.
That's right.
Can't move his arms for CrossFit.
CrossFit. Flexibility.
Thank you.
The Yoshi.
It is. Yoshi.
What are we looking at now, Finn?
We're doing minutes, and Frank is
contemplating.
I had to separate it out here. I have one comment that's not an approval of
which
the 21st.
Well, let's start with the 7th. We're going to do all them right. Individually. Let's start with the 7th.
Oh, CrossFit. Yeah.
3 minutes.
What's about the Parker Rec? I motion that the minutes from November 7th, Monday, November 7th, 2016, be approved as written.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. I heard.
Second.
Yep. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Now we're discussing the minutes on November 21st, 2016. And Frank?
I just have a discussion point. It's not a change. I was just wondering, Superintendent McLeod mentioned...
It's on page 4 something. Like, there we go. At the bottom of...
A letter from the chairman of the school committee was supposed to be sent to us about information about school enrollment, I guess, and we haven't gotten that, at least as far as I know, and I guess it's kind of moot now because we do have numbers
I think the office got it.
Elaine received two things from the school department after that meeting and gave me copies, but did tell me you needed to see them, so I filed them away. I can pull them out if you need to see them.
Do we need to?
She just told me to file them with the master plan stuff. So
There's no questions for us from the chair? Or
no, it was just these are the numbers.
These are the numbers.
Kind of thing.
So it's already moved. Okay.
Yeah.
So I motion that we accept the minutes from Monday, November 21st, 2016 as written.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Now we're talking about December 5th.
It was a minor thing I noticed. It was about the park and rec, but I think we already passed it. So
No. You're on page like 6-ish. It's item 4. So it talks about Fruit Street proposed changes to site plan. Right down at the bottom on your left.
Right, on a page, the next page after 4, on section 4, they mentioned that they are more expensive because they have 3 bathrooms. And I just want to have it included that we suggested that they have 2 bathrooms. Just not labeled male or female, because they were concerned about transgender issues. And that didn't make the minutes.
I don't know whether we came up with a recommendation on that, or quite remember.
I don't think we did come up with a recommendation.
I don't think we talked.
Well, I recommend.
Well, there, no.
Frank did mention it. I remember now that he says it, but.
But they aren't aren't putting the names on. These are family restrooms, so yes. Mm-hmm. You find an open door. So
they are basically unisex bathrooms.
Yes.
But then we don't need 3, we need 2.
No, they need 3 based on the number of kids that are going to be playing. So they've decided that they want 3 people to be able to go all at once. Mm-hmm. But not together.
Well, maybe.
Well, yeah.
Can you clarify that one?
I would like it noted that
I think that number 3 was more to save on lines in the bathroom versus male, female.
Yeah.
It's male, you know what I'm saying?
They specifically said they wanted 3 bathrooms, male, female, and transgender.
No.
They just one that brought up transgender.
No, they said that.
No, they did.
I did not bring it up.
You brought it up.
I did not bring it up.
No, they brought it up. I remember it.
Okay.
Because that was the reasoning, I thought, for why they would need 3 restrooms.
Well, I thought it was just number of kids.
I do.
It doesn't have to be included. I don't know.
I don't think we should get that into the position of regulating bathrooms, and so I'd leave it out.
Well,
yeah, I agree.
The reason I want to talk about it, not necessarily, I mean, I want it in the minutes because it was in the meeting, but you said you were going to take our advice about, and we had a consensus that you were not to support it, and it said in the newspaper that it passed unanimously in the CPC.
I spoke out slightly against it. I guess I didn't speak out loud enough.
Actually, were you at that CPC meeting?
What?
Was that the meeting you missed, the CPC meeting?
No, I was there.
There.
I did miss one.
Because when is... This is going to have, there's a lot of people calling me about it, and there's going to be a lot of opposition to it.
I'm not.
And I want the minutes to reflect the actual.
Yeah.
additional, not
you
no offense.
Mark, you can mark it up exactly what you would like. In
we'll put it in these minutes.
Why don't we read? You give her what you want in there, and we'll talk about it at the next meeting.
All right, thank you.
Sounds good.
Okay. Now we're into goals. John, I think you have some work that you've done.
I've got some parking. Just pass the stand.
What are you got now, Ken? Where are we?
Goals.
Oh.
Looking at, and I wanted to give some background and then kind of a simple, which we can make as complicated as we want. Under state statute, municipalities can pass vehicular and parking regulations. We don't have any in town. If you look at it, we don't have any parking regulations, we don't have any traffic regulations. The first page applies to, I'm sorry for the misorder that I put the two out earlier. This applies to state highways, and this would be a very comprehensive parking restriction. And this is what is currently state statute for state roads.
Would that apply to 85 and 135?
Correct. So this is background information.
Also West Main Street, right?
No, that's not a numbered road.
No.
Underneath the bridge is a state road.
I thought West Main Street was all state because we had to get the...
Maybe just under the bridge, but...
Not the whole Cloverleaf is a state road.
It is. Yeah, I think it is up until the gas station.
Yeah. Let's give them that third one. Yeah, I agree. That's section of 495.
Now, the next two pages, and I wanted to concentrate on sidewalks rather than just parking because it was basically sidewalks. The next two pages are just some background on snow removal. We're not saying snow removal up to the homeowner. Many municipalities, if you look at it, who the more urban towns do put onus on all of the, basically all the sidewalks in town have to be cleared by the adjacent homeowner. Many of the sort of between 495 and 95 say some roads designated, basically say some are town handled, some have to be cleared by residents and others not. This is more general interest that the courts are going in the direction. Everybody kind of thought if you left the snow the way it was, you're better doing that from a liability point of view. But if your municipality says you have to clear and somebody slips, this is more just background information for you. A very comprehensive looking at it, I pulled Newton here.
Before you jump, so that sidewalk for snow removal, we don't have anything in place.
Correct.
Right.
Well, we don't have any...
Nothing on anything.
Nothing
right.
on
anything.
So
just that you can't throw it in the street.
We don't have this. Is there a snow removal throwing in the street in the?
Yes, there is. There is a bylaw that says that you cannot throw any snow, any debris, anything into the street from your properties.
Did you get in trouble for that?
Do I?
Did you?
No.
I'm impressed that you know it so well.
That's why you go by my house and you see that I'm on the wind drift. I have to put everything on the wind drift.
It's interesting. If you look at Newton, which is the second to last page, pretty comprehensive and detailed. Many towns have had restrictions on sidewalks so long they refer to coal dust and stuff like that. I mean, you can tell it, but you're looking at it. So I tried to come up with something very simple, just relating to parking on sidewalks.
And this is that proposed language?
Right. So no person without permission from the selectman or police officer shall place or cause to be placed upon any public way or sidewalk any object, including the parking of cars, trucks, or other vehicles, in a manner which obstructs the safe passage of pedestrians or vehicles. The parking of cars, trucks, or other vehicles in a private driveway, and this is up for discussion. Some prohibit it completely. Some don't mention it at all, but the parking of, so I put in a 3-hour period here. This is really up to, it's across the board from town to town. Number of times, some require you to go and get permission from the police if you have to park and block it for a period of time. So just threw that out there. The car or truck must be removed after 3 hours or after 10 minutes. My wording is off. I added this in late. 10 minutes after being asked to do so by a police officer. So just giving the police the right to say you've got to remove that evidence. No person shall ride. I put this in here because we do see people riding bikes and stuff on sidewalks and up sidewalks. And it's contrary to any of the state laws. And
I'm not sure. Question about that, because
I have a
I'd rather have
too.
Kids ride a bike on the sidewalk than ride it in the street.
Yeah, under Massachusetts law, a bicycle is a motor vehicle.
Correct.
And is not permitted to ride.
But
on
we
a
don't
sidewalk.
Have to call it out.
Well, that's
say we don't
yeah.
allow it.
All right, and then I got something to ask you.
Hold on.
Why don't you go through the whole thing?
Second area is just structures. I don't know if this applies. Many of the towns have it. So I decided to put it in there as any structure over any sidewalk without a permit. Has to be 7 feet over. And third, we had talked about not maintenance to the extent that you have to fix it. Everybody basically says town road, town maintains and fixes. But the adjacent property must maintain the public sidewalk free from the growth of bushes, trees, branches, or other plant material, which restricts the safe usage of the sidewalk by the public. So if you've got a bush and the branches are over and blocking the sidewalk, you've got to trim the bush.
Reasonable.
What?
Common sense.
Are you not doing anything about snow?
I don't. That's a big open issue, and a lot of the... Most of the towns, similar to Hopkinton, either don't mention it at all,
right,
or have this tri-level, where certain parts of it are handled by the town, certain parts have to be cleared, and certain don't have to be.
Because basically, again, the
so
town.
So we do have a section that says no person shall pile, push, throw, shovel, plow.
Right.
Or any other method or means cause snow to be deposited or placed on any public roadway or sidewalk of the town so as to impede, obstruct, or interrupt, or otherwise adversely affect the unrestricted flow of traffic or the safe travel of any pedestrian on such roadway or sidewalk.
It just means you can't add to it, but
doesn't say you have to clean it.
But if you get to the point of cleaning it, the police could ticket 95% of the town, all these developments.
Yeah, because when you clean it, you got to put it in the...
No. I'm just talking about the fact that you have to clean it. I don't think we should force people...
No, absolutely not.
This is saying that you will, right?
Well,
no.
I thought it said...
This isn't anything about snow.
I don't have anything on snow.
Sorry. So
you left
that's
snow.
What I was going to say.
I was agreeing with you.
Sorry, yeah. That we shouldn't put anything because...
I also think you get into the whole argument why, well, if the town's cleaning this sidewalk, why do I have to clean mine?
Right. But
and I don't know.
But also, there's a lot of these residences. The roads are so quiet. There's no reason
to
do the sidewalk.
John, if I may, just add something to you through the chair. What about sidewalk usage for signage for like restaurants and things like that? Putting out signs.
Sandwich boards.
Good point.
I wrote that down because we do allow every business to have one sandwich board.
Yeah.
And a lot of them put them on the sidewalk in front of it, especially
so
in the downtown.
Now the question then becomes, do you want to say...
It just throws a big wrench into your terminology here about anything. It says placing any...
Well, let's step back. Which obstructs the safe passage of pedestrians or vehicles.
But that's determinable by what? If
you have a sandwich board and you allow a sandwich board and it takes up the whole sidewalk and somebody has to walk in the street,
Yeah, but some could construe. Some could construe. Maybe you have a 2 foot sandwich board, and you got 2 feet left of sidewalk, or 3 feet, or whatever. What is a sidewalk? 4. David.
ADA compliant will be 6.
Huh?
If it's ADA compliant, it should be 6.
It should be 6 feet. That's with 1 foot setback. So it's 5 feet, right?
Mm-hmm.
Is it, David?
I don't know.
Okay.
Now, what are you? Just looking at, what are you trying to allow that or not?
To allow that, because that is a business advantage to most people that are running businesses. And so when people are walking by, if there is a 3 foot passage with a sandwich board, I don't want to see businesses lose business or creativeness.
So can I? What are we trying to stop with number 2 from happening today?
It's applied in number 1 or any object.
Right.
Well, this basically would apply to like the sign or hanging Hopkinton gift.
Right.
That it's got to be 7 feet high. Or Hopkinton. What?
Which is probably not.
Remember when the antique store was in and she always put out a sign, a sandwich board sign?
They all do it. Spoon does
Everybody does.
Right. Does it.
So if you take that away from that.
What would you change? Would you say it's permitted even if it obstructs the safe passage?
Well, I think there's safe passage. To me, you know, two people walking hand in hand, if they come up to a sandwich board, they walk around the sandwich board.
What wording would you change?
That's why
I'm saying safe passage.
Why don't we all think about that and we'll put it on the agenda for our next meeting?
We're still going to talk about the bikes.
What's the enforcement?
Yeah, and what's the other thing is everybody else
fines.
Fine, boom, boom, boom.
And who enforces it?
And I'm going to think a lot about the paragraph that talks about riding on roller skates and inline. I'm worried that if we put that in there, we won't pass it at town meeting.
Right.
Well, just keep in mind that the new sidewalks in the town center are going to be a combination bike lane and sidewalk, right?
Yeah.
That's what they're talking about for.
Yeah, I think so.
They're talking about doing something.
Bike lane will be separate.
Mm. Okay, I thought they were talking about a combination.
I don't know. Typically, the bike lane is a separate.
Let's just keep that in the back of your mind because it might.
The other one to think about is that blocking of the sidewalk and a driveway. Because that's across the board.
That's a little interesting.
Most don't mention it at all, which leaves you the impression that if you're blocking it, some say you can pass over the sidewalk, but you can't block it with a parked.
Oh, I'd be the number one offender in the town.
Yeah.
And the reason why is because my house existed from 1851. They took eminent domain of my property. My truck and my car don't even fit in my driveway without going out to the end of the sidewalk. Yeah. So I
on Main Street?
Or? Yeah, on West Main Street. So
yeah. You need to buy a shorter car, Cliff.
Yeah, but I guess
they don't make them.
You would get an exemption.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a little different. That puts you in a hardship. What are you going to move your house? But I think the ADA, I mean, how are we helping them? If we're not doing the sidewalks, getting the snow off, if we're leaving sandwich boards in the street, how is someone in a wheelchair supposed to get down Main Street Hopkinton? They can't. And we put in all these ramps so we can accommodate them, and then we turn around and tell our neighbors, don't shovel your sidewalk.
You bring up a good point though. Maybe can we focus this on just the downtown area when we talk about snow being removed?
Well, let's think about it.
The downtown.
Let's all think about it, and we'll
bring some language related to that to help the discussion.
Okay,
it might help.
Good.
All right. So then, in that instance, please include, because I'm thinking of myself alone, not. Not that I'm the only one, but there are some old houses that have short driveways.
Okay.
So I think John has done a good job giving us a bunch of things.
Absolutely.
Thank you, John.
Okay.
You did a great job.
And let's pass this down around.
Pictures.
The stop signs got put in on Wilson Street in the middle of the snow, I think, last Friday. So we got that. approved.
Oh, look, a double pole.
And
oh, that's beautiful.
And I just was checking this.
And
Thursday, I didn't see that.
Oh, oh, your helicopter. What does that sign mean?
For those of you,
oh, stop signing.
Yep. So that's that part's done. They kind of tabled the parking on the sidewalk down there by the dog shelter at this point. They're working with Elaine to try to get permission to use the State Farm canoe ramp access road for parking. The state doesn't plow it in the wintertime, so the town has offered, I think, to plow it for them. I don't know where that is, and maybe we can, you can get a kind of input, but last time I drove by it, they were still parking all over that. Yeah. McDowell thinks that, you know, he's trying to find a date to have the ceremony to open up the road.
Okay.
That'll happen, I think, sooner than later, but who knows?
I ask a question? Franklin Road, that beginning where the guardrail is, they can't plow it well enough for two vehicles to pass any longer. When they plow that section where that new guardrail is, it encroaches on the road. So they can't push the snow far enough off. If you noticed after a storm, there's a significant amount of snow in the roadway, and you actually have to cross the yellow line to drive up that street. I don't know if you've noticed that. I've done it twice now this year.
Okay. Well.
So.
Grab a photo next time you see it.
Yeah.
May need to move that guardrail back inward a little.
Okay, and then the last thing I've got to bring up is, I don't know whether everyone saw the article that basically they want to add, and it said in the article 4 classrooms, but I thought each of those modules were bigger than 4 classrooms. And they're talking about an additional $2 million. Somewhere they saved $2 million under the construction budget so that they could kind of, you know, the bids came in cheaper so that they can apply that. So they're not asking the taxpayers for that. My question that I came off is basically, does this new addition have any of the fixes that would be needed to make the exemptions that were granted under the Dover Amendment go away? You know, we're talking about that at a town meeting, and whether, such as this, and whether or not they have any changes to the parking lot or stormwater based on, or did what we approved the last time assume for stormwater that the additional building was going to be built there?
Chair, somebody here brought up that, are we building it big enough?
Yes.
And the question, and then the answer was yes. But came up in that discussion was here's where we put additional classroom.
Okay.
So it'd be good to see, does this match where they're planning on putting it? Does it match what was discussed?
And what's the new plan for additional classrooms after this?
Yeah.
Well, if they would do
a new school,
they won't give center school back.
Yeah,
more air conditioning.
Whatever, we can think about it because we'll have another meeting before the 30th.
Do we know what's going to happen with center school afterwards?
No.
I thought I just saw in the paper that they were going to be changing that to office space.
Why isn't it made a youth center?
Well,
that's a great idea.
They're supposed to appoint a committee to do that. As far as I know, Selectmen have not done that.
I think a year ago we can put a letter together. We recommended all these things that you guys are talking about.
Yeah.
Yep.
Hopefully.
So anyway, we'll talk a little bit about the new school.
Right.
But you know, if they're asking for money, should. What I'm thinking about doing is maybe sending a letter to the school building committee and maybe the school committee saying, with this additional money, are you asking anything to make it in compliance with the site plan review and not require the exemptions from the Dover Amendment?
Should
we open that can of worms, are
you? Should we have them? Should we have them come before us? Is there a new plan?
They will have to eventually. So.
And we all want to know what happened to the...
Do you think that opening that can of worms is a bad idea? I mean...
No, I mean, if they have to come before us, why not? It doesn't hurt to ask.
Yeah. Okay. And I'd ask them before the town meeting floor. I'm going to give them the courtesy of a warning so that they know that
they
might
be
coming.
Prepared.
Yeah.
Question to Jen?
Yeah.
Jenna, we're going to get a completed copy revision of the final final master plan in February, you said?
Well, at our next meeting, we're going to have to talk about all the planning board recommendations in the implementation page. We also owe stuff in that area.
Can we just move everything that's this planning board to another committee?
I make a motion.
Can we get a draft of the article for the sidewalks from the DPW?
Well, he said he was
going to. Well, that's for the May one. I don't think they've been even drafted.
Yeah, just saying.
We will.
Sometime
sure.
Before that. Okay.
Oh, yeah.
Thanks.
Okay. We could ask the director, DPW director, to come in one of our meetings and give us an update on how he's coming on the sidewalks.
That'd be nice.
Provide a written thing.
So this seems like this new development off Chamberlain is going to take up a bunch of our time, right?
Yeah.
I have a question on that. I actually live on Chamberlain Street. Is that going to be a problem? I'm not within 300 feet. I'm in the middle.
I don't know. Maybe we talk to town council.
Okay.
Maybe, but.
Oh, yeah, I'll just be sitting with all my neighbors who are all behind me tonight, so.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You're getting lots of
Do we know what happened to the Dynasty bathroom? Because the big
to-do
is.
Touchy subject. Touchy subject.
Okay.
Right.
Never mind.
I don't know.
Okay.
Nobody knows. It's okay. We'll find out later.
Okay. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. How do you vote on a motion to adjourn?
Aye.
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 We're adjourned.
What happened to the dinosaur?